Hello, everybody. I'm Howard. I met you all, I think, this morning for a few minutes. Accenture, Solutions IQ, Accenture. You can see two cultures coming together. It's been fun. And today, we're going to talk about unlocking business agility, holistic transformation in uncertain times. Sounds complicated. It's really about disruption. You guys feeling disrupted at the moment in any way? Yes? No? I'm a little bit disrupted. About 3 weeks ago, I moved with my family from the US to Stockholm. Moving three kids and a family halfway around the world is quite disrupting. Packing up your house, selling everything that you have, is quite a big upheaval. And during the time you're doing it, you're feeling all the habits that you used to have changing. And it feels quite stressful. But 3 weeks later, we're here, we're in Stockholm, my kids are coming to Riga tonight, and we feel pretty settled. I'd say it's been quite easy for us. But we also moved the cats. Okay. So a little thing, apparently, you may or may not know, but in Arizona, where we lived, you can't actually fly your pets out of Phoenix from May till October. Right? It's too hot. Right, it gets to like 50 degrees Celsius at the airports, and so they don't allow you to take your pets out. So to get the pets from our house to Stockholm involved having them sit in some sort of feline penitentiary for 3 weeks. Then somebody actually has to put them in a car and drive them 8 hours across the Mojave Desert to LA, where they then arrive at the busiest, most miserable airport in the world. And then they have to get flown from LA all the way to Stockholm. So for a cat, that's disruptive, right? Or not. This is Thompson. This was taken yesterday. He seems to be doing quite well. Lives in the sink, he likes to sleep in the sink, and he's obviously also adapted very well to his disruptive conditions. So I wanted to start by demonstrating that even humans and animals can adapt to disruptive situations. Also showing cute pictures of cats is a good way to start presentations, I've heard. So business agility, what is it all about? So I know the topic of today is about back to basics, and I'm definitely going to touch on that as we go. But I want to also really ask us to stretch ourselves and start thinking about what agile means to organizations. In today's day and age, it means being able to respond very quickly, develop a culture of continuous improvement and continuous innovation, but do it in such a way that it's built as a cultural habit. It's not a project that's done in 6 months. It's something that becomes part of the DNA of an organization. Now, every CEO around the world may have something like that in their "we must do this if we're to survive" agenda. But it's really hard. It's really hard, and Gartner will say that more than 90% of transformations right now are failing. So we're going to explore a little bit why they're failing and what's going wrong. And you've probably started to pick up some of the patterns throughout the day. We've heard some discussion about that. But I'm going to drill down on what some of those patterns are, what some failures we see are, and how we approach business agility. So let's start with an agile team. I like this picture. It represents in my mind what some of the good things about an agile team are that we look for. What do you guys see here?
Get fun together.
having fun together, human beings, right? Somebody playing a role. I see some fun. I see some comfort in being together as a team. When an agile team's working well, those values that we love, it's a wonderful place to be. Okay, it's a place where there's trust, there's transparency, there's teamwork, and there's a common purpose and a vision. And that's why many of us, the question was asked earlier today, why do I do what I do? I'm a believer. That's why I do it. I've seen the old way of working, and I believe there's a new way, and I've seen it. And I think people who embrace working in agile teams, they start to believe it as well. And over time, this team develops habits. And the habits are what are really important here when we think about organizations. There's a great book. I don't know, has any of you read this book, The Power of Habit?
Great.
I love this book. It's Brain Science. And it's really about why we do what we do, what triggers, cues happen in our mind, what routines do we follow for what rewards. And these habits are prevalent in organizations. And changing habits, we all know, if we try to go to the gym or we try to change what we eat, habits are hard to change. Let's try a little experiment. Okay, I'm going to have to do this without a microphone.
Okay, everybody stand up for a second. Right, find your wrist first. Okay, I want you to hold your hands out and turn your palms out. And then pop one hand over the other. So your thumbs are at the bottom, okay? And then everybody turn your thumbs up. That was pretty easy. That's the only reason I really kept my jacket on.
That's a magic trick.
All right, I'll show you guys later. But it's about habits, okay? It's about things that we just are hardwired in our brains. And when we try and think about agile in organizations, it's about those habits. So what are some of the habits that we see that are good about being in agile teams? Well, we've touched on those. Autonomy, Mastery, and Purpose. Also a fantastic book by Dan Pink, okay, about drive. The intrinsic motivation of people, why we do what we do. Culture of experimentation and learning. Honesty, transparency, having fun together. Being able to work on something and retrospect and learn and get better at it. That makes us happy. We like to get better. And getting something real at the end of what we do. There's a sense of outcome, there's a sense of fulfillment and purpose if we deliver something. Now, these are habits that when organizations say we want to be an agile organization, these are habits we'd like organizations to have. The problem is, these are the habits that exist in many large organizations around the world. They're habits that have grown up through, in many cases, 50 or 100 years of working practices. Ever since Taylorism was invented, ever since McKinsey developed the management principles and management consulting approach. Organizations have annual investment allocation plans. They work in a project mindset. A project mindset means when it's finished, we're done. And they walk away, and people walk away from work. Despite the fact we want to work in this environment of collaboration, we stick and we have organizational hierarchies and structures. The conversations in organizations tend to be about utilization. How busy are people? And how much is it costing me for these resources? Those conversations are because it's much easier to measure IT, what it costs, than it is to measure value. What we really should care about is value in what we do, not how much it's costing us. I could have a conversation with any CIO in the planet where if I said to them, if I could double the value for the same amount of cost, would you be happy? They would say, yeah, of course. Would you care about cutting costs then if we were doubling your revenue? Of course not. So the conversation has to shift, right? So focus on output, and leaders need to be the people that know. So organizations typically don't allow for vulnerability. They don't allow for leaders to say, I don't know the answer to the question, because knowledge is power. And if within an organization I'm rewarded for being a leader, I need to know. And we're also rewarded for doing more. I don't know, I often have this conversation, you get in an elevator with a colleague at work, how are you going? Busy, very busy, very busy. How are you? Oh, busy, busy, busy up here. Well, wouldn't it be refreshing one day to get in an elevator and say, how are you doing? I'm working at a sustainable pace. Okay, because we just don't think that is a socially acceptable answer. We have to portray how busy we are and how many things we're doing as a measure of our worth and our value, because we recognize that organizations value us doing more things instead of limiting our WIP, getting to done. So the point is that the cultural behaviors organizations are looking for don't align with the values and the culture that we want and we see in agile teams. Fundamentally, there is a mismatch right now. And it's a real problem because organizations say they want to be agile, but they don't know how to change their cultural habits. So I've got a question. Is it actually possible? Is it possible for us to actually take agile principles that we want in a team and scale them to still achieve company objectives? So back to basics. This is one way I believe we should, and we encourage organizations to look at their world. How many of you are familiar with Schuhari? Great. So this comes from Japanese martial arts, and it is a method of learning a kata or a movement to become an expert. And the pattern of learning is first I must understand and learn the rules. Once I learn and understand the rules, then I understand enough to experiment and bend the rules. And after I've learnt and experimented with bending them, I know enough to make or break the rules. Now, this pattern of learning sounds simple, but organizations look at it the other way round. Organizations we work with many times believe they know how to implement an agile transformation program. They've never done it before, it's never worked, but they know what's right for their organization. And in fact, instead of taking Scrum, we're going to do Scrum, but, okay, we're going to change this and we're going to scale it this way because that fits with our processes. Okay, and we're going to do it as a big bang, and we're going to change everybody in one go, and we're going to make and break the rules first. And it comes from a what we call, like, it's organizational hubris. Hubris is like arrogance, because to ask for support, to ask for help, it's not in their company culture. because they're very smart people and they should be able to figure this out. And we don't really want a coaching, we'd rather do it ourselves, thank you. And whilst we would love for them to do it themselves, everybody needs a coach. If you're learning a new sport, you get a coach. If you're a soccer team and you want to learn how to play rugby, you're going to get a coach. Otherwise, the minute we go into scrum, all the soccer players will fall over and start crying and holding their legs. They need to learn the rules. So it's very hard to have this conversation with organizations about you need coaching because they believe they can do it themselves. So this is a barrier to entry. If we can get them to look at learning the rules first, to start experimenting with change, just like we would expect an agile team to experiment with change, if we can get them to think about retrospecting on what has happened to determine, have I got any empirical data to know whether what we're doing is right, then we should be able to get organizations to learn what is right for them, understand how it may fit in their organizations, and then over time, understand what to change. And we won't get into this translation, as we call it, instead of transformation. Translation is when you show up for a sprint review meeting and it's just the same old project status meeting that it was 2 weeks ago, but they've called it something different. So I'm going to talk really quickly about three common failure patterns that we see in organizations. There's at least a dozen, and I could spend a lot of time on this and tell war stories about all of them. But we'll talk about three that are very relevant to the basics and why we think about agile values within teams. So number one, stop treating your agile transformation program like a waterfall project. Even in the last few weeks, I've spoken to organizations that approach transformation with this is our plan, this is our design of what we're going to do, okay, and we're going to take requirements from all these people, and then we're going to build it out and roll it out to all these people, and then maybe in 6 months' time, we'll implement it. Okay, so 6 months later, the CEO who's been paying for their transformation program is asking, so how come I'm not seeing any return on my investment on this transformation? Well, because we haven't implemented it yet. Okay, trust me, sounds crazy, but it happens everywhere. Who would think about an agile transformation program as a waterfall project? Organizations that haven't developed that cultural mindset or change. And a big part of number one is the enablement team that often gets set up. The leaders of the company that have now delegated the transformation to this mid-management group, their center of excellence and their head of this and head of change and head of cultural change. Do you think they're working like an agile team? Do you think they're developing a backlog for their transformation and they've got a product owner? Okay, and they're deciding how to prioritize their backlog of transformational change. And what are we going to accomplish in our first sprint? Okay, they rarely are doing that. And that's a real problem. Unless we get them to work like an agile team, they're just not embracing the habits and the values that they want to see everybody else embrace. Second one is inadequate measures. So what is our measure in a sprint of progress? Working software. So how do you think we're measuring our agile transformation program? How many scrum teams have we stood up? How many safe agile release trains have we launched? You know, how many people have we trained? Okay, They're not value-based metrics. And that's a problem. And so again, when the CEO asks, how's it going? Am I getting any of my stuff? Are my customers any happier than they were 6 months ago before we turned the organization upside down and made everybody use Scrum? The answer is no, not really. Okay, so we need to get people focused always on value, customer value. And I want everybody in the value stream from marketing, finance, product development, engineering, production support, all thinking about why we're changing to deliver more value for the customer. And then the last one is this culture. It is not a process implementation. A transformation is a cultural change program. A cultural change program takes a long time. Culture is the last thing to change in an organization. We need HR there at the table. We need some investment in what type of people do we need? Where are they going to sit? How are they going to work? Not just a cool new office without thinking about what it's going to give for the people. But change is often overlooked. Those are three patterns, and they all talk to why organizations don't think like agile teams. Agile teams would think like this. They would tackle those. They would work in agile frameworks and use agile principles and values. Okay, they'd measure their progress the right way. And they, over time, would develop a culture of themselves, and they'd be aware of where people coming into the team might not gel. They would try and fix it. Okay, so we often talk about, we've got to move away from this concept of outperforming the competition, because it's just such a steady state, and we want to create learning organizations that think like agile teams. I want to get better in the next iteration forever. I want my transformation program to last forever. It's not done next year. It's going to continue because we'll never finish changing. So we need to move and help companies understand there's humility in asking people for advice, and humility and vulnerability in saying, I don't know the answer. Let's try it and find out. And we believe that when we talk about transformation, it's about a really fundamental change. So if you get attached to in companies working in businesses where they're rolling out Scrum or they're trying a pilot program, okay, ask, why are we changing? What's wrong? What problem are we solving? Because unless a company really feels like if we don't change, we're going to die, if we don't change, we'll miss out on this market opportunity, then frankly, it's probably going to be too hard. There needs to be a real compelling reason for companies to go through this change. So that takes us out to how do we think about this? So when we go in and we say, okay, so we hear you want to change, fantastic. And we hear you've got a really compelling reason for changing. You want to disrupt the marketplace, or if you don't change, you're going to be out of business in 5 years. Fabulous. Let's talk about how to look across the whole organization at agility. We start with what we call delivery agility, product innovation, organizational adaptability, and leadership effectiveness. And I'll try and make this super simple. If there isn't some program to create a valuable, fast, high-quality flow of software in your organization is a problem. If there's no DevOps work going on, if there's no focus on speeding up the engine room of delivery, then everything else is going to fall apart. And it's not a separate effort, it's just a necessary part of creating lean flow through the business. If I'm a product owner and I have this really cool idea for this product I'd like to test with my customers, so I go out with a bit of innovation and a prototype, and I get a bunch of customer research, get 20 customers together, test my idea, and they love it, I'm going to want to go back and I'm going to want to build that thing. Okay? I don't want IT to say, sorry, can't do that. We've got our quarterly release plan and our legacy systems, sorry, aren't going to support that new cool idea. It's going to take at least 6 months before we can try and get that prototype, even to a proof of concept. As a product owner, I'm going to say, well, that's no good. In 6 months, we'll be too late. Okay, so we need to have this delivery agility spinning to enable some product innovation. Does that make sense? Now, we need this engine room of product innovation to spin, but it can't be a hobby. It can't be just something that companies want to do on the side, you know? It's a little bit of a product innovation project. It's a hobby project. It has to be totally embedded in how people think and work. We need a culture of innovation. Because ultimately, we want to take that idea and we want to build it out and we want to go and test it in the marketplace. Now, what happens now is we get stuck in the next layer. Right, we try and scale our really cool idea that we've just tested, and we want to actually make a big bet on it. We want to take a whole suite of investment and put all the company's money behind this great idea that our customers love. Sorry, can't do that. Can't do that till next year because we've got a plan, okay, and we've got a budget, and that's my money, and that's not your money. And I've got my money and I want to spend it on this other stuff. And I'm not really incentivized to build your idea. I've got my own plan. So now the culture of the organization, the silos and the way that companies run are going to stop that innovation. And they prevent us scaling ideas and creating agility at an organizational level. I've seen many transformations fail because of the way that we code our finance projects in our systems, or because of the way that money gets allocated on an annual basis. We can't become fast unless we change some of those systems. But those systems, they're really hard to change. Changing how we code projects in finance has been around in this company for 40 years. We'll never change that system. We'd have to throw out the ledger. We'd have to change the way we do everything here. And we can't change that incentive plan because that's how I get paid. And that's how my bonus gets given out. And so I don't really want to change that plan. Why should I give you my money? So things like HR systems, incentive plans, finance systems, they stop transformations dead in the water. So I asked another question. Is finance on board with this transformation program? Are HR involved in this transformation program? Are we looking at how we incentivize teams instead of people? If we're not doing that, again, it's probably going to stall. And then the last layer is to change those systems, we're going to need leaders. We're going to need the leaders of the company to say, I care so much about this change, and if I don't get that good idea out to my customers, we are going to die. So we've got to change that finance system. So maybe we should experiment. Maybe we could try a change in a particular area and see if it works. Maybe we could imply some agile values and principles in how we think about our investment planning or how we think about our incentives for people. So we want that agile mindset and that culture in the leadership of the organization. If not, it's just going to die on the vine. So that's how we think about the lens of business agility. We have to inspire the whole organization to change, and we have to remind people it's very hard to do it. So you really need to be committed. It's a long journey. And that's why many companies fail. And so coming back to the basics again, we are asking the organization to think like that, to think and work like an agile team everywhere. This is not an IT thing. This is a company-wide thing if they're going to get any value out of this. And I'm a believer, so I believe it's possible. So to answer my own question, I think we can do it. But it's going to take a lot of time. And we need people who are also believers to keep asking the right questions, challenging and embracing agile practices and values. Cool. So that's it. Any questions?
So my question is, usually when you say to organizations we're going to deliver the value, how you actually like characterize what is the value? Because it's hard to measure, right? And how do you explain to the business what is the value?
So we'll start with what we don't want. What we don't want is 20 KPIs. Okay, we're measuring this. Right, we want maybe two things. And what we care about is either how fast, how good, how much, or how happy. So what I mean by that is, let's say it's how fast. If that is what the company cares about, maybe our measurement is cycle time from idea to product in the marketplace. If it's how happy, maybe it's a NPS score of our customers or our employees. But what we want to pick is something, and we want to measure it on a regular basis, not in 12 months' time, because we're trying to see quickly if what we're doing is making a difference. So to pick the other two, how good might be a quality measure. Defects in production. Okay. And then how much might be how many features are we putting out on a quarterly basis? So are we measuring an increase in our ability to deliver value to the customer? So those simple quadrants are how we typically look at it.
And the board would sign off on that.
If we can turn one of those into a cost-based or a revenue-based metric, so the cycle time might be measured in hours, which people which might have a dollar value against it. It might be measured in whether the product actually generates revenue. We have to turn it into whatever the company cares about, whether that's top line growth, customer satisfaction, but it can't be a vanity metric like how many trains we launched.
How do you bring this mind-breaking idea of company to consider instead of doing more and more and more or bigger, instead of that, do better, different, sustainable, that type of shift?
That's a tough question. Through experimentation. So what we want to say is we need to try something different. We wouldn't be here having this conversation if you didn't believe something was broken. Okay, so let's try something. Let's try an experiment. What we don't want is that big bang waterfall approach. So we'd like to start something and test and learn. So I want to find one flagship program, ring fence it, free them from traditional cultural boundaries, and let's see what happens. Put agile teams on with the right culture, and let's see how it looks. And what we find is that when it works, people, I want some of that. They want to be in the team that's working well, or the program that's working well.
Can I go? Hey, we tried a little bit of feedback today with the takeaways, right? That was one interesting format, and we were just discussing if we should try another liberating structure for similar activity. Would that be okay? Guys, are you okay to try something different for the feedback this time? Huh? Exactly. Go with this first. That was awesome. I almost like bended my knees or whatever, elbows upside down.
So your arms are always going to turn the easiest way they can, which is in opposite directions. But you don't want them to turn in opposite directions. So what I did is I went like this. I did spend about 5 minutes outside.
Stretching
the muscles, so it didn't look